Okay, hello everybody. I'm here to pretty much this is the start of a new format for my videos. As you can see, I pretty much made this video on Windows Movie Maker now, and sorry that it's been a while for me before my last been a while since my last upload. I've been trying to figure out this damn thing, and it's been hell, but, so this is my first, review. New using Windows Movie Maker. And, so, today's album, as you can probably guess, is The Sane Asylum by Blind Illusion. Clocks in at about 40 minutes long, but it's a great album, nonetheless. It's probably one of my top 10 favorite albums of all time. Of course, this is kind of an underground, the thing is, this is kind of an underground, as I said, this is an underrated metal classic, pretty much because it doesn't really go anywhere. It didn't really go anywhere, however, it's kind of developed a cult following over the years. You may recognize, two of the people in the lineup for this album. Particularly Les Claypool and Larry Lalonde, who would eventually go on to do Primus. And so Claypool and Lalonde, Claypool's on bass, Larry Lalonde is on guitars. Larry Lalonde, essentially what had happened here was, there's the only permanent member in the band, Mark Biederman on vocals and guitars, and then there's Mike Miner on drums. So, essentially, this is the history of the band. The history of the band, let's see, they pretty much started 1979, I believe. I would think, just a second here. Yep, 1979. They started out mostly rooted in progressive rock. Mark Biederman has cited bands such as Rush, King Crimson, and Jethro Tull all as very, very big. on the progressive side. However, of course, seeing as the band was formed in the Bay Area, you also tend to be influenced by the bands that come around. And of course, around the early 1980s, started the Bay Area metal scene, which would include bands such as Metallica, Exodus, Testament, and of course, Blind Illusion was one of the lesser known of those bands, unfortunately. But they definitely but they were definitely one of the best to come out of that scene. They had a basic, and actually, it, and again, they would incorporate more heavy metal elements to their sound. Porcupine Tree's Steven Wilson actually described their sound as being sort of. Described their early sound as being sort of in the veins of old Judas Priest, Angel Witch, and early Fates Warning. So kind of progressive influences, but definitely really so definitely some progressive influences, but really on the metal side for sure. The original lineup was lineup of the band was Mark Biederman on lead and rhythm guitars, Keith Stewart on vocals. Les Claypool on bass, and Brett Hearn on drums. Les Claypool, of course, would be in and out of the band, would join the band, would ended up, left the band. Biederman has been pretty much with the band throughout the entire time. Keith Stewart was in the band for a little less than a year before he was replaced by David Godfrey, whom you may recognize a bit more from the band Heathen. In fact, by the way, Mark Biederman did play did play bass on Heathen's Victims of Deception. So if you recognize the name Mark Biederman from anywhere else, you'll probably recognize it from that album. So this is definitely a very... So, yeah. And then, of course, Les Claypool has been in and out of the band twice so far. He joined at the very beginning. He was in there at the very beginning, as I said. He stayed in the band until about 81. Rejoined the band in 86 after unsuccessfully attempting to join Metallica. And pretty much stayed with the band through the tour of this album. And then he left with Lalonde to join Primus. Other bassists have included Alvin Petty, Chris Olsen, Gino Side, Larry Lalonde actually did do some bass back in 1988. Actually, you know what? I think that this might be an error here. I'm kind of reading from the Wikipedia article here. Then there was also Adam Gates and Vern McElroy. So, McElroy all having played bass. On guitars, they've had Brian Kehoe. So Brian Kehoe, Hans Larsen, Pat Woods, John Marshall, of Metal Church was actually a member of the band in 1987, but only for a very brief time before being replaced by Lalonde. Before that, Lalonde was playing in what many people arguably consider to be one of the first death metal bands, actually. A band known as Possessed, and then Ian McCaskey, formerly of Exodus. Then after Lalonde came in for an unspecified time after Lalonde, then Mark Strausberg came in, followed by Eric Meyer. And then the drummers have been Brett Hearn, Bill Tiscott. Then from 79 to 83, he was the founding drummer. Bill Tixon in 83, before being replaced by Mike Miner, who pretty much went from 83 through 88. And then Wes Anderson took over after the Blind Illusion tour. The Sane Asylum tour, I mean, sorry. But yeah, Blind Illusion has kind of had has not really had a stable lineup over the years. Probably the most stable member, I'd say, aside from Biederman, was Mike Miner, who was a member of the band from 83 to 88. So, the band hasn't exactly had a solid lineup. But, it took them a long, long time for them to finally get this album out. But when they finally get an album out, and they released the album The Sane Asylum on Combat Records in the year 1988. The lineup, of course, was Mark Biederman, Les Claypool, Larry Lalonde, and Mike Miner. And the producer was Metallica's Kirk Hammett. Now, the reason why was because Les Claypool and Kirk Hammett were good friends back in their high school days, and of course that was how Les Claypool got in touch with Metallica, and how he once attempted to join the band unsuccessfully, of course. But there was several. But Les Claypool. There, and I don't know if he had any connections with Larry Lalonde at all,
Probably just because by being in the Bay Area thrash scene, but I do know. But of course, Of course, we all know that Kirk Hammett was taught by Joe Satriani, and actually, so was Larry Lalonde. In fact, little known fact: Joe Satriani co-produced Beyond the Gates and produced The Eyes of Horror by Possessed. The last two studio releases that Possessed ever made. So, this was definitely a very... This is definitely a very, very well done record. I mean, you can definitely hear the progressive influences here. It's definitely a thrash record, not to say thrash record, but the but definitely the progressive influences do indeed come up. You can hear that, especially I would say probably in the songs "Death Noise" and "Metamorphosis of a Monster." Maybe somewhat in "Vicious Visions" too, but and again those are the longer track. But definitely you can. But it's not just prog. There's also a lot of other influences. There's a little bit of funk. You can kind of hear some funk influences going on, kind of with Les's bass going on under everything. So yep, that's the song "Smash the Crystal." It's got some great solos on "Smash the Crystal," by the way. Same thing with "Death Noise." But again, this is a very aggressive and a very dark album. But it's not. It's kind of like progressive dark. It's not like black metal dark. This is like the kind of dark that I feel when I listen to records such as "A Pleasant Shade of Gray," or like a "Pain of Salvation" record. But despite that, this does not sound at all like either of those bands. This sounds more like this sounds more like Gay Lee joined Slayer is what I would say this is. And how good this ended up becoming, because most thrash records kind of fall for similar. The only problem I have with a lot of thrash records is that a lot of them have the tendency to fall for, very little originality. Sane Asylum is the exact opposite. It's very, very well. It's very, very well done and very original. And I definitely think that it probably was good that this band actually was given so much time to finally, so much time between their founding and their first official release, so that way they were able to perfect their material. It's kind of the same thing. I mean, they were able to perfect their material and get what they felt was right. And then there was supposed to be, this is kind of like, it's kind of like the Van Halen heavy metal release of heavy metal. Because of course Van Halen, when they first released their first album, they had been doing demos and been playing in clubs for years, and they've been able to perfect their songs to the point where they sounded really good. Same thing with Blind Illusion, just the only difference, this is a metal band, and of course Blind Illusion is a metal band, and it's a very, again, it was really. I mean, you want to get signed as quickly as possible, but sometimes it might help to actually perfect your material before you get on here, which is kind of why I was not
That might be kind of the reason why not particularly like Fates. Well, I did like it, but not quite as much as their other records. Why I did not quite like Fates Warning's first record quite as much as I liked the other records that they did. Because, and I mean, you can tell that they were kind of rushed in that. But here, you can definitely tell they were able to work out everything, make sure that everything was pretty much up to par. And they just released some great, they're just some great songs off of this. I already played Blood Shower in the intro, and I'll probably play the end of Blood Shower for you guys as well, just so you can get to, you can hear a bit more. But so yes, but yeah, I mean, as I said, Blood Shower, Death Noise is very good, Smash the Crystal, Metamorphosis of a Monster. The opening track, I really like the opening track, despite only being about an hour and, a minute and 40 seconds long. It really helps set the mood, set the overall atmosphere and mood of this record. And I honestly do not, and this is, and again, do not really see really much flaws, except for mostly, I'd have to say that it's mostly has to do with production and also kind of with Biermann's vocals, but that's not a huge problem with mine. So, but yeah, this is great. This is a great record overall. The songs are excellent and they're well constructed, very well constructed. This is probably one of the best, if not the best, release of the Bay Area thrash metal scene. So if you ever get a chance to find this record, do indeed buy it. It's a hell of a ride, and it's great. I don't even own this record. It's that rare. It's very rare. It's a very hard to find, and it's definite. If you can find it, it's like a really, really great addition to your collection, because you own a piece of history with this. Especially this, since this was kind of the intermediate point of Larry Lalonde's career, before, and of course this was kind of before Larry Lalonde and Les Claypool would go on to join Primus, and yeah, definitely. I mean, this is definitely kind of like a stepping stone for their career, despite the fact that this is probably the best thing either of these musicians have ever been in. But nonetheless, if you ever get the chance to, I mean, seriously, if you find this record, buy it. It's rare, and it looks really good in your collection of metal albums overall. By the way, though, I would advise you, stay away from Demon Master. From Demon Master, their second album, which was released, just last year, actually. It's not good. It's really just kind of blues rock with some prog influence and a little bit of, yeah, so Demon Master was pretty, was a disappointment when compared to it. And they were actually going to release another album, in either 89 or 90 called, Psychedelic Symphony. Unfortunately, it was never made because, the band broke up. So, and of course, eventually, Biermann reformed the band, but, that didn't quite go as planned, unfortunately. The reunion didn't quite go as planned, unfortunately. But definitely, if you ever get a chance to, pick up Blind Illusions to Sane Asylum, please do. It's a great album, and you will not regret it.